Thank you, really very stimulating. But can you say something about the concentration that you can reach in the bowel and in the blood of delphinidine, just using this extract?
To be really honest, these animal studies, we have just finished the statistics for the biological endpoints and the bioavailability studies. I just wait every day now for the statistics. I'm sorry for that. But, well, the paper will come out soon, so we did all the data, but I haven't the
this
final
This can be
results.
Relevant for the but issue of protecting the gut and not, yeah. not damaging the general yeah. systemic
from,
effect.
From the numbers I've seen so far, as you would expect, the level seems to be extremely low in the plasma. Yeah, this is as expected, and we see a little bit of the respective acids, so protocatechoid acid. You don't see the gallic acid because it's too unstable. That's a difficulty. But you, when I remember it right, you reach a quite high concentration in the colon. So there's a study from the group of Elke Riechling in, on ileostoma patients, and they showed that up to 80% of the orally given bilberry reaches intactly the colon. So the concentration can be high.
Per il dottor Morazzoni, vorrei avere delucidazioni circa la tecnica fitosomiale, quindi la compressazione con fosfolipidi che so che viene utilizzata per una migliore biodisponibilità, quindi miglior assorbimento. In particolare ho visto la curcumina, ma anche l'escina so che viene fitosomializzata, se si può dire. Può darci qualche aggiunta?
Sì, posso rapidamente riassumervela. Intanto l'idea del complesso con i fosfolipidi non è evidentemente un'idea nuova, esistono a livello di tecnica farmaceutica una serie di precedenti che hanno portato poi a identificare i fosfolipidi come un potenziale improvement di biodisponibilità. Il fitosoma è sostanzialmente un complesso che viene ottenuto in laboratorio utilizzando la parte, diciamo, di derivazione botanica, che può essere anche una molecola purificata. Noi abbiamo fatto complessi fitosomiali anche con molecole pure, oppure anche una miscela complessa, come per esempio un estratto. Naturalmente queste famiglie chimiche devono avere alcune caratteristiche chimico-fisiche di idrofilia e di coefficienti di ripartizione particolari. E quindi poi vengono fatti reagire utilizzando un solvente protico, noi ormai lo facciamo con un processo food related, quindi sono solventi utilizzabili in campo alimentare, e poi viene riprecipitata appunto con un altro solvente. Si ottiene sostanzialmente una polvere che contiene il complesso che è ottenuto praticamente con un'interazione a legami a idrogeno tra la parte polare del derivato botanico e la testa polare del fosfolipide. Quindi sono complessi che hanno un certo grado di stabilità. Per esempio, se lei li confronta a un liposoma, sono molto più stabili, ma ovviamente hanno anche un grado di instabilità. Quindi, per esempio, in solventi acquosi i prodotti tendono poi a rilasciare i prodotti complessati, e ovviamente dopo ingestione normalmente questo avverrà nell'ambiente gastrointestinale, però presentano un grado di protezione di molti di questi prodotti che hanno un metabolismo presistemico e che sarebbero altrimenti demoliti. Per esempio la curcumina è proprio uno di questi.
You showed that can you hear? Yes. That you, if you inhibit topoisomerases in terms of catalytic activity, you can impair the activity of anthracyclines and so on. But another possible consequence of this inhibition would be that you inhibit DNA repair. So if what happens if after inhibition you expose the cells to, let's say, alkylating agents or reactive compounds that can produce DNA damage? You can end up to have a higher carcinogenicity of other compounds that cause DNA damage.
Actually, the answer is quite complicated because, well, it I should have talked 1 hour on that. But the point is that you have a concentration range where you have this clear overlay of catalytic inhibition and topoisomerase poisoning, where you decrease the DNA damage. But if you go much higher with the anthocyanin, and I'm not sure if you can reach that in vivo, I don't know yet, then you have one effect, which is an suppression of the regulation of topology. And this gives you torsion stress in the DNA, which might even give you DNA damage by these compounds per se. But it's a kind of a distance. So the question is, in vivo, where do we end up? Do we get to that torsion stress part or not? And the other thing is, which might rule out that difficulty, is you never can shut down DNA transcription completely, otherwise you go into apoptosis. And what we see at the same moment is an increase in DNA repair, and I don't know the mechanism yet. I see it on the base of transcription, that all kind of DNA repair enzymes are going up in their transcription concomitantly. If you increase, of course, you come to that point where the cell just dies, okay? But there is obviously a window where you suppress the poison and you enhance the repair. I don't know the mechanism yet. And, well, if you go too high, then you have DNA damage.
We study in several cases these polyphenols, endocyanidins, and so on. There is a kind of common leitmotif, which is the inhibition tyrosine kinases. You show something, inhibition enzyme dealing with the DNA. The common motif could be related to the binding site that mimic ATP binding. In other words, if we are dealing with an ATP or the adenine or nucleotide binding site, which could be a specificity versus anything else, maybe other kinases, serine kinases, other kind of enzymes. So the point is, what about specificity? Stay in a concentration that give a possible hit for the story of a concentration. The group has been shown that for anthocyanins, continuous treatment in the brain, you can easily reach 1 micromolar, which is not dramatic, can do something. And so in your concentration use, which is the support, or you can say in support or specificity of the interaction with the enzyme, where the active site is the active site of the adenine nucleotides.
So, at the moment, we think, indeed, it's the ATP binding motif. And as I probably showed, is that at least all receptor tyrosine kinases we have tested so far are suppressed. However, there seems to be a differential pattern. If I compare that to quercetin, the pattern of inhibition is different, interestingly. So with quercetin, you would have expected that it also binds at the same binding site. So you should have the same activity against the same receptor tyrosine kinases. You target them all, but to different extent if you compare it to anthocyanins. So this positive charge in the molecule seems to trigger something. And if you come to topoisomerases, it's even more important because, interestingly, quercetin acts as a topoisomerase poison. Epigallocatechin 3-gallate is reported as a topoisomerase poison. Isoflavones do, but anthocyanins don't. And the difference, I think, is a positive charge. I don't know yet what really is the trigger on the molecular base, but there is a difference in, I wouldn't call it specificity, yeah, but the pattern is different.